programming digital contracts. So go ahead.
And there are, of course, some connections to the aforementioned things. Yeah, thanks for having me, and thanks, everybody, for staying till the bitter end. So yeah, this seems to be working, right? The microphone, good. So this is, in this talk, I'm going to talk about NOMOS, which is a programming language we're developing at Carnegie Mellon. So people involved in this are Stephanie Balzer, Ankush Das, and Frank Fanning. And Ankush is my PhD student, and he did the majority of this work, and also I took some slides from him. Yeah, NOMOS is a programming language for implementing digital contracts. So what are digital contracts? So these are programs that carry out financial transactions between potentially distrusting parties. Yeah, so often in the transaction some money is involved, but doesn't necessarily have to be. What's important is that once they are published, their contracts, they cannot be modified anymore. They can have, and usually do have, state, though. Yeah, so I'm mostly going to talk about smart contracts, which are digital contracts that are stored on a blockchain, but most of the things I say also apply to other settings where you would have kind of like a trusted third party, like a bank, that would store the contracts. In all of these cases, though, the community somehow needs the consensus. If you use such a contract, you send some money to the contract, yeah, then something will happen. Some money gets sent to somebody else, maybe. And the community has to find a consensus what is happening when you use this contract. So somebody has to execute the contract, or in the case of a blockchain, possibly multiple people have to execute it. So the question arises, who is going to pay for the execution cost? And there are also the possibilities of denial of service attacks. So how this is done right now, for instance, on the Ethereum blockchain, is that the users, when they want to use a contract, have to in advance provide some gas, which are similar to money, to pay for the cost of the execution. So if they don't give enough gas, then the execution will be aborted, the transaction will not happen, and they lose the gas that they provided. If they give too much, then they get reimbursed the amount that was not used up. So what's interesting about these smart contracts is that bugs in them can result and have resulted in financial disasters, and also bugs cannot be fixed anymore after the contracts are published, or at least it's very difficult. And here are some of the famous bugs that caused a loss of money. So can programming languages help to prevent bugs? Well, yes, of course they can. So if you think of like memory safety, Microsoft estimates that like 70% of the security vulnerabilities in their product code is caused by issues with memory safety. So you just use a language that's memory safe, and 70% of the security vulnerabilities go away. And so why don't they do that? Well, there's a lot of legacy code, and also like the developers are trained in these existing languages. Yeah, there are some social factors too. But here in these digital contracts, you don't have this problem so much, because there's not a lot of legacy code. So it's not only a domain where people really care about correctness, it's also a domain where you can restart from a clean state, of course, a clean slate. Of course, there exists already some work in this area, but not as much as, you know, compared to regular software products. And in NOMOS, what we do is we build on the state of the art, kind of like what are the, you know, safest languages you can have right now. So this is probably a statically typed functional language. So this is what we start with, and this is also not a very unique. A lot of people in that space make this proposal. And what the research is about is kind of like to additionally address some of the domain-specific issues that arise, that are like the root causes of a lot of these bugs that you see in these contracts. So what are these domain-specific issues? I want to explain that with an example. So let's say you want to implement an auction. So the auction can have two states. So either it's running, yeah, and when it's running, then you can have some bidders that can place bids I'm in the auction, and you know, after some time, the status changes to ended, and then we determine who the highest bidder is, gets a lot, and the other bidders get their bids back. So how would you implement that in Solidity? So here, the state of the contract is a hash map that maps to each bidder the bid, and we also keep track of the highest bidder and the highest bid in these two variables, right? And if a bid comes in, we store it. So this is the function that stores a bid. We store it and then update these variables, highest bidder and highest bid. So then there's a function collect here that you can call if you want to collect your bid. So this can only be called if you are not the highest bidder. So match the sender is not the highest bidder. So this requires kind of like a guard that says like, yeah, the function can only be called if this condition here holds. So you get the amount out of this hash map and you send it to the sender. So, and I claim there are four bugs in this function here. So two of them you should be able to spot. So the first one is, I think that's the first one. Yeah, what happens if you call this function while the auction is still running and has not ended, right? So this, we said like in our protocol, should not be possible. So this is the first thing we should fix. So we add another require statement up here that says like, okay, the status has to be ended, otherwise you cannot run this function. Good. So what is the root cause of this? So the protocol of interaction with the contract is not statically enforced. Yeah. So you want to kind of like have a check that enforces that, like, yeah, this protocol really holds for the code. So okay, we fixed that. So now we have this here. So the second bug is that, yeah, let's see if it's really the second. Yeah, so what happens if you call this collect function twice, right? So then you can collect the amount you paid two times, yeah? So what we really have to do is we have to update in this array that this pending return for this particular sender is zero. Yeah, so so we have to add that to the code. And what is the problem here? So the money is really a linear resource. So you cannot send it to the sender and also keep it in the hash map. So this shouldn't be possible. It should be treated like in a linear way. So you would get an error here statically that you can't do that. So that's a second thing. And so then there are two kind of subtle issues. So now we inserted here that like the pending returns of this particular sender are zero because it got collected, but there are still two bugs remaining. So the first one, and that is probably something you don't know, is so if the sender here is another contract, then the send function here will transfer control to the other contract. So that happens if you send money to a contract, you kind of like call a function. So what this other contract can do then is do a callback into the same function here. So then you execute this again and the money is sent again and you never reach this line over here where you serial it out. So you can again like drain money over and over from this contract. Yeah, and this is a so-called a re-entrancy attack that is possible. Yeah, so what you have to do is like you have to switch things around, and you first have to set it to zero and then call the send, so to fix that. Well, still one more problem left, and this has to do with the gas usage. So now you still have the issue here that you might potentially call another contract. So now, you know, imagine you're a user, you want to estimate what is the gas cost of this function, and you cannot be really sure what is called here in this function. So what they do like in Solidity is you have to explicitly provide some amount of gas you send along here. You don't know how much it is. And if it's not enough, then this payment gets aborted. And you only learn about that by checking the return value of the send. So that's like the last thing you have to do. You have to check the return value and see if there was enough gas to execute that. You get an out of. So the underlying issue here is that, have these out of gas exceptions and you want to reason about the gas cost statically, maybe. Okay, so to summarize, so the domain-specific issues are the resource consumption, the out-of-gas problems, then the interfaces, so you want to have let the contracts have like clear interfaces, how to interact with them, and they should also be enforced by the language. And the third thing is, you want to keep track of the assets, so they should not be duplicated and also not be kind of like lost into some void. And these are the three things we do with NOMA. So as I said, we start with a statically typed strict functional language. So strictness is important to reason about the cost. It's difficult if you have like a lazy language or something like that. A statically typed already rules out a lot of the errors, and then for these like three domain-specific issues, we use things that we have developed at Carnegie Mellon in the past years in different contexts. So I and my group, we developed this automatic amortized resource analysis, which we use to get the gas bounds. We use a linear type system to keep track of the assets, and we use shared binary session types to enforce and describe these contract interfaces. And the automatic amortized resource analysis and the binary session types, they are both also based on linear type systems. So these kind of like three things fit nicely together give like a nice type theory. I'm not going to talk about the NOMOS type theory at all in this talk. I'm just going to talk about the automatic amortized resource analysis, how that works, and then I give you a bit of an impression how the binary session types work and how you can use it to implement contracts. So first part, the automatic amortized resource analysis. So this is a type-based technique that given a functional program, we want to answer the question, what is the worst case resource consumption of the program as a function of the input sizes? And the resource can be clock cycles, heap space, or in our case, gas. So the technique is parametric in the resource. And we have to find bounds with concrete constant factors, not asymptotic bounds. So that's also what Don Knuth did in his book, The Art of Computer Programming, if you remember. But the difference here is we want to do it automatically. And in our setting, it's also important that we produce certificates that are easily checkable. I'll come back to that later. So the technique we use is basically the potential method of amortized analysis. So if you think of a program as being a control flow graph, so what we do is we define at each node of the graph a potential function that maps the state of the program to a non-negative number. And then for each transition in the program, we ensure that the potential you have at the node is sufficient to cover the cost of each outgoing transition and the potential at the next node. So if you do that for all the nodes in your graph, then you know the initial potential is an upper bound on the cost you have no matter what pass you take through the program. Now we want to do that automatically, so we want to find these potential functions and we want to do it with a type system. So to do it automatically, we fix the format of the potential function. So you can think of that a bit like a basis in linear algebra. And to do it in the with a type system, we kind of like come up with type rules that produce local constraints on the coefficients of these basis vectors. So that this is the idea. So this has a very clear soundness theorem with respect to cost semantics. And through the types, it's very compositional. And it also allows for efficient inference with LP solving. So it sounds very complicated, but it's actually very intuitive. So let's look at an example here. So let's say you have a append and a functional language, right? So the lists are immutable. So we have to copy X over to append to Y. And let's say we are interested in the heap space usage. And let's say for each new node that we generate, we have cost 2, right? One cell for the data and one cell for the pointer to the next element. So the cost for append is then 2n, where n is the length of the input list, right? The evaluation would look like this. So the list is copied over. So in this case, it has 3 elements. So the cost is 3 times 2 is 6. So before I tell you how we analyze that, I want to make it a bit more complicated because I want to show some features of the analysis. So here you have 2 appends, right? So you have 3 arguments. First you append X and Y, you get T, and then you append T to Z here. So now it's already a bit more complex. So the cost is 2n, n is the length of X for the first append, and then 2n plus m. So m is the length of the second list, and the length of T's n plus m. So this is the cost you get. So now we want to use the potential method to reason about that. So what do we do? So we say, OK, we have 4 units of potential for this list X. We have 2 units of potential for each element of this list Y. And we have 0 units of potential for this list Z. And this kind of like specification is independent from the length. Yeah, you say per element. And so now in our concrete example here, we have in total 4 times n plus 2 times m potential units. That's exactly the bound we want to prove. So what we now have to do, we have to argue that like this potential is always enough. And to prove that, we kind of like simulate the execution, but we would only do that kind of like in the proof, basically. I mean, this is a static technique, but this is kind of like how it would look. First, we would do the append X to Y. Yeah, so X, this list is being copied over here, and 2 units of potential per element we use to pay for the cost, and then we have 2 remaining per element, and we can use that to attach it now to this new list T here that we generate, which is conveniently now a list that has 2 units of potential per element. Now we do the next append, copy this list over, and we use the potential per element to pay for the cost. So this is basically a proof, if you want, yeah, that this initial potential is sufficient to cover the cost. I mean, intuitively, this is a proof. Why did I pick this like more complex example? Because I want to show you that you never have to reason explicitly about the size of the data structures. This is all implicit in this potential method, and this is why it works well, and we can automate it. So this is very important. Good, so I told you that we do that with a type system. So how do the types look like? So here for the first append, we say, okay, for the, we take as input 2 lists, we produce a list. So here I said the elements are integers. And here these red annotations, they are the potential annotations. So here we say, okay, you have 4 potential units per element in the first argument list, and the second argument list here, you have 2 units of potential per element, and then you produce a list that has 2 units of potential per element, and this is completely independent of the size. That always works. Yeah, question?
Question, so how easy it is for people to annotate this?
Method? It's all automatic, completely automatic.
How do I know to annotate 2, that each cell has cost 2?
Well, so you mean the cost?
Yes.
Well, this is up to you. You can pick. the cost metric is completely user defined. So you can even in the program insert, if you want, tick expressions. You can say, okay, at this point I want to have cost 50. At this point I want to have cost 100. The technique is completely parametric in the resource metric.
I guess I'm just wondering from the user's perspective, how do I know that I want to? I mean, I could of course put a very high number. That's right.
But wait, so there are two different things. I mean, the first thing is the cost metric you use. How do you define the cost of your programs? So, well, there are multiple things you can do. In like here in our case with the gas usage on the smart contracts, you usually have this definition given. They usually have already a high level cost metric that you can use. If you talk about something like clock cycles, that's more difficult to do. So that's also like an area of research that I'm also interested in. But for instance, stack space or heap allocations, that's actually pretty straightforward. You can look at a compiler and inspect it and so on. And yeah. But for us, we just say like, yeah, this is already given and we just want to analyze it. Yeah. So here, for this first append, you have a different type than for the second append, right? For the second one, we said like we have two units of potential in the first list, zero units of potential per element in the second list, and then everything is used up. Oh yeah, also these two numbers here is a constant potential that you need that is not attached to a specific data structure. So in general, we can assign to append like a type like this, where we have like unknown potential annotations and then some linear constraints that you can derive from local type rules. I didn't show you that. And then you can solve these constraints with an LP solver, and depending on how you use the result, the LP solver will pick one of these types for your function. Good, so I talked about linear potential functions. If you assign potential only to one element of the list, then you get linear resource bounds. As I mentioned before, so it's completely parametric in the cost metric. I showed you how you reason about heap size, but you can do the same for clock cycles or number of execution steps or gas, whatever. I explained how this analysis is compositional, because you don't have to reason about the size changes, right? Resource analysis is always about the size changes of the data or the numbers. You have like implicit in this potential. I also didn't show you that, but you can maybe imagine if you have like these linear annotations, right, you do like a cons, you can exactly see what happens, one comes out, and you can assign the rest to the tail. You can express that with linear constraints. Type derivations in the type systems are actual proofs of the bounds. So what's interesting is that you can kind of like transfer all the benefits to a setting where you have polynomial bounds, multivariate polynomial bounds, things like n squared times m. You can still get the bounds with LP solving only. So yeah, this is actually quite expressive system, and we implemented that in a research language called resource-aware ML, which has the, I would say, main features of OCaml. And just to give you, you can try it out. There's like this web interface here, and you can also do that for imperative languages, but I'm not going to talk about that today. Just to give you an impression what it can do, so here I selected some textbook algorithms and the hope you still remember some. So for instance, here we did quicksort, but with linear comparison. So we do quicksorts for list of lists or for strings, you can think, right, where each comparison already has linear time, so you get a cubic bound. So this is the computed bound by the tool. This is the actual asymptotic behavior. This is the runtime of resource-aware ML, and these are the number of constraints that we generated. And here you see for this quicksort, we get a bound that's asymptotically tight, and the analysis time is less than a second. And in general, the analysis time is relatively small, mostly under a second. And here we derive evaluation step bounds. So that's kind of like a high level cost, like resource metric that is defined by our operational semantics. Right, what else did I want to point out here? Yeah, I think that's probably what I want to say. Oh yeah, here I want to say for merge sort, you see we can only derive a quadratic bound, but the worst case cost of merge sort is n log n. So yeah, we cannot get a tight bound for this one here. Good. Yeah, we proved, of course, that the analysis is sound, but still these constant factors that we get might be completely off from, was that the question?
Yes. Are the values of the constant and SM consistently shown, like in this analysis runtime column?
Yeah.
So when you report on the runtime, do you show the same values for n, m, and the other?
Oh, wait, here you mean in this column?
Yeah, because for example, we have Dijkstra's shortest path, which is O of n squared, and to report runtime 0.11.
Yeah.
And then merge sort is O of n log n, the same runtime.
Oh, no, this is the runtime of the tool. The analysis, so the output of the analysis is what you see here, and this is just the runtime of the tool. Yeah, this question I get a lot. I don't know how to present it differently. Right. So this is just the runtime of the tool. It has nothing to do with these parametric bounds. Yeah. Good. Yeah, but another question. Yeah.
Can you say a word about what the constraints exactly are?
Oh yeah, right. Yeah, so this is these are things. So yeah, where do these examples come from? So some we just wrote ourselves, but some we got also from libraries, or in the case of square root, from the extracted code from the verified comcert compiler. So in this function, yes, square root. I mean, it looks very harmless, but it's actually a pretty complex function. Yeah, I didn't report the number of lines of code, but like yeah, it's relatively complex because yeah, they have like a binary encoding of numbers as a data type, right? And then they do the computation on that, and so it's a it's actually surprising that we can analyze it at all. So that's why you get a pretty complex number. We also only assign the potential to data structure. So now you here in this computation you have a lot of data structures. So that also what brings the number of constraints up. Oh yeah, I should also mention, by the way, that this is only the time you need for inference, right? So if you would put the stuff on the blockchain, you would only do the type checking, which is linear in the size of the program. So that would be much more efficient than doing the inference. So this here is the inference. Yeah. Oh no, it's not tighter. Look, you have the. Oh, yeah, because we can only, so we have like this basis in the analysis. So we say kind of like the bound has like a polynomial shape, and then we fill in the coefficients. So this is kind of like a template-based approach, and we don't have this template. And it's very, very difficult to get this for us because, yeah, for the, why does it work well with polynomials? So if you have a quadratic potential assigned to a list and you make it shorter, then you get something quadratic and something linear. And for the logarithm, it's kind of like weird. What you get is, yeah, when you have, you know, the difference between log n and log n minus 1 is what? It's something like, you know, 1 over n. And this is something we cannot, you know, we cannot use to pay for anything. It's kind of like a weird thing to have around. So it's, yeah. But polynomials, it's kind of like a nice function space to work with. You can introduce some ghost variables or things like that to express a logarithm, and then, but this kind of like, yeah, so you can do that, but it's a little bit cheating. Yeah, it's not directly expressible in the system. Okay, so yeah, right, what I wanted to say before is, so the constant factors, I mean, they are sound, but they could be completely off, right? So we did some experiments. It's worst case analysis, so you always have some, you know, for quicksort, for instance, a list, well, quicksort is a bad example, insertion sort, a list that is already sorted where you don't hit the worst case, but here we manually identified worst case inputs and just, you know, ran the code, counted the number of steps it took. These are the red dots. And the blue line is the bound we derived. So if you have something like evaluation steps, you get really very, very tight bounds. So this is not just like one function I picked for a lot of them. You get very good bounds here, longest common subsequence. Again, the red dots, the measured worst case cost, and then the blue lines, the bound that we got. Of course, it's not always tight, and there's no guarantee for that or anything. Yeah, I can. If you're interested in that subject, I can tell you a bit more about it, but I want to move on. Okay, so yeah, this amortized resource analysis, it's a type-based technique for deriving these worst-case bounds. It's compositional. It can be integrated like in a type system. It's expressive. These bounds are these resource polynomials. Reliable. We have formal soundness proof. It comes with certificates, and it's completely automatic. No user annotations are required. So. Yeah, it's a particularly nice fit for the smart contracts because they are often short and they are not very complicated. Like the programs I showed you here, like in the evaluation, they're probably already more complex than most things you see in smart contracts. But, you know, maybe in the future that will change, but at least currently. Okay, so if there are no more questions about this, then I move on to the second part about the expressing in NOMOS the interfaces to the contracts, and we do that with these shared binary session types and yeah, shared resource-aware binary session types. Actually, it sounds again very complicated, but it also looks very complicated this time, but it actually isn't. So I explain how it works in a sec. So binary session types have been developed in the context of message passing concurrency to describe data that is sent on a channel between two processes. And yeah, they I mentioned that only to justify that the types look are so unreadable for some people. So there's like a correspondence, a Curry-Howard correspondence to linear logic. So that's why in the types you see these connectives of linear logic. But I explain how that works. And also these channels are bidirectional, so you always have dual types for the provider on a channel and the client on a channel. Yeah, we'll see that here with this example. So let's say you want to implement a queue, so you always have to say now from, because it's dual, from what viewpoint you see it. So let's say we are the provider of the queue. So then the first thing we want to say is that our client has an external choice. So the client can pick either I want to insert something in the queue or I want to delete something. So if the client says, like, I want to insert something, then the control remains kind of like the token is still at the client. The client has to send the element, and then we are done with the interaction. We kind of like behave like a queue again, kind of like, yeah, the cycle is complete. If the user or the client wants to delete something, then yeah, the token is kind of like on our side. Then we can say either none, there's, you know, nothing in the queue anymore, and we terminate, or we say, okay, we still have something, then the control remains on our side, we send the element, and then we behave like a queue again. Yeah, so this is how that works. A little bit like a state machine, right? So it keeps kind of like track of the state, but the nice thing is that, of course, we also have a type system, and you can enforce that some code implements this type, this kind of like state machine. The big thing about session types was always that a type sound theorem implies deadlock freedom. We still have that to some extent, not really, because we have these shared session types. I'll come back to that. To give you a bit of an impression how it looks to implement such a queue, you can implement the queue in different ways. So here, if we in NOMOS, you wouldn't do it like that. But if you have only pure session types, so some you would maybe do it as follows. So you would have a list of processes here that represent the queue, and every process contains one element of the queue. It's not a very efficient way of implementing that, but just to demonstrate how it works. So then in the implementation, you write here on the right-hand side the channel that you provide, which is a queue. We implement our queue. And here on the left-hand side, the channels that you use to provide this service. And here is this is the side the client interacts with. And here we find the next element of the queue. And here the next element. And here this is the current element. So now the first thing that happens is that the user sends one of these labels, insert or delete. So we have a case analysis. If we get an insert, we just pass this element down the queue. So first we receive it from the channel S, then we send it along the channel T down the queue where we want to store it. Then we behave like an element again. So this is this here. If there's a delete, we are in the case where we have an element. So we send and then we send this element X here. And then we terminate and move this channel T to the next thing down the queue. There's also this empty thing here that has a different implementation I didn't show you. But this is just to give you an impression. It's clear that you cannot fully pass that now. Yeah.
So just big picture, you started talking about smart contracts.
Yeah.
But there, and here you have a logic for message passing.
Yeah.
There every call or every contract executes atomically as a transaction. So where is the message passing?
Remind me later. I can talk about that later. Yeah. Let's talk about it later. So the important thing is, you could always have a smart contract and a state machine on the side. The important thing is here with the session types, you have again linear type checking, and you can check that your code really implements such a protocol. Back to smart contracts, right? So how would that look for the auction? The auction would first send you as a user, if it's running or not. If it's running, then you have the control. You can send a bid. If you send a bid, then you have to send an ID for who the bid is, and then you have to send the money, and then you behave like an auction again. This is recursive. Or if it's ended, the user can only send this collect. Then an ID, and then we have the option to either say you won, you get the Mona Lisa, or you lost, you get the money, and we behave like an auction again. So this is roughly how you would describe it. This is only in the vanilla session types. So now in NOMOS, you have this functional base language on which you add the session types. So now every process, and the contract later on will be a process, stores functional data and also stores potential, like you have seen before. That's why it's resource aware in these functional data structures that it locally has. And this potential can, of course, now also be transferred via messages. So you can either just like send, I have it down here, some constant potential along the channel, and this is also part of the protocol, as you will see later. You can now say in the protocol, well, send me 10 potential units now, but you can also say something like, send me a list with potential 2 per element, or number that has potential 2, which would be like size of the number times 2, that can also be part of the protocol now. And we still have the efficient type inference that we had in the functional layer. We also get that for the functional layer combined with the session types. The user still doesn't have to write these gas annotations, these potential annotations. This will be automatically inferred. So here is the auction again, together with these potential annotations. So also, I didn't talk about that in this talk. This is now a shared session type. So usually, if you have like the normal binary session type, you can only have one channel of communication. So now, how will it be on the blockchain? So on the blockchain, you have like an atomic transaction that will usually start, and there was a question before, by acquiring a contract. So here this is like this up arrow, that means kind of like you have to acquire it. And then you have an atomic transaction until you release it. You can only release it though, and this is also checked in the type, if it's an auction again. You cannot release it somewhere in the middle, you know, when you're like in the middle of the protocol where the next user would know what to do. I can't release it here. I have to release it over here when it's an auction. So in here it also says, so we call that equisynchronizing type. So what it also says here, you have to send at the beginning 11 gas units, because this is kind of like the worst case you can have when you go through the code. So this is the worst case pass here that is most expensive in our cost model. Doesn't really matter what it is. You can also have some gas that you have to send like in the middle, but it's not necessary. The only other gas annotation you have here in the end before you release it, so this is when you don't take the worst case pass, then the user gets some of the gas back. And you can set up the type system in different ways. You can set it up so that this is always precise, that never gas is lost. That comes with some remedies, but it's not a big surprise, because if you have worst case bounds, I mean, what you can do is you can still track it at runtime. You only know you will never run out of gas, and then you can, give the remaining gas back. So that's kind of like trivial that you can do that. But yeah, you can do that. You can set up the type system so that it's like always precise. But that's not what we did. So we said like you can have some loss in gas, so that's also not a problem. Yeah, and so otherwise the type looks pretty similar to what you've seen before. So here you have yet another symbol where you would send kind of like a functional value along that looks different from a linear value, but the general idea is still the same. Yeah, so this I explained. Are there urgent questions about this? Yeah, so wanna talk, here I have like an implementation of this. So it looks very similar to the thing I showed before. So this does implement everything. It's just like the this one pass. So the type is a little bit different, but this is kind of like how it would look. You wouldn't have actual contracts for receiving and sending these potentials, but they exist in the language, but they would be inserted automatically for you before type checking. So this is what the inference does. Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about the, if I'm still allowed, 5 more minutes.
Yes.
about kind of like the high level picture, how you kind of like would implement it and kind of like what you can do with it. So in most of the cases you can get away with like these constant gas costs, but sometimes you want to iterate over some data structure, so you cannot statically put like a limit onto it. And in NOMOS you always have to prove a gas bound. So what do? So you just give up? No, of course not. So there are two things you can do. So the first one is you can come up with some kind of payment scheme where you do this amortized analysis. Yeah, if you have like a situation that happens sometimes where you only iterate over the list once, right? The users that come before you that make this list longer, that make it unpredictable what the size of the list is, they can pay in advance. You know, for every element they add to the list, they have to pay some gas that is then stored with the list. So this is what we call a payment scheme. So then the cost is nonlinear and one non-constant in one transaction. It's linear. But the cost gets amortized because like users before pay a little bit more that then benefits the user that has like the high cost later. So sometimes this is not possible because you want to iterate over a list multiple times. So then what you can do is you can add like an argument that has to be sent like by the user saying n, kind of like which would be the limit, how long they would be willing to iterate over this list. But then it has to be explicit in the code to make this type check. You would have to not only parametrize on the list, but also decrement the number as you go along, because yeah, the number carries this potential. And if you don't decrement the number, you don't get the potential. And you would have to say then in the code what you do when the number is zero, but there's still some list left. So this is up to the developer then what to do. And it's made explicit. It's not like a silent exception anymore, so it has to be part of the contract. And you can, of course, if you don't want these things, like that the contracts carry potential, you can easily disable it, and then you know everything has to have a constant cost. It's also possible. It doesn't come with it. So, how does it look on the blockchain if you implement it? So the kind of like blockchain state, which is not really existent on the blockchain. You only store the transactions, but still kind of like there's this virtual state that the miners compute when they do the transaction. So how would it look? So it would like look like this. You have a bunch of processes that store inside functional and linear data. And they are kind of like, from an operational semantic point of view, they're kind of like in a stuck state. They cannot execute by themselves. So now when a transaction comes in, this is also a process now, process that can like acquire some of these contracts. And in this configuration, you're not in a stuck state. You can now execute it. And what is the execution model? You don't only call one function. You kind of like execute this transaction until this client terminates and leaves the state again, like in such a stuck state here, and then you can accept the next transaction. So this is the execution model. Does the user have to write this client code over and over again? No. You could, of course, equivalent to the current kind of like methods that you have, you could have like, you know, predefined clients that the user could select and put in there. Yeah, so this is not really exposing anything bad to the user. Good, of course, in such an execution, you could like spawn new processes that become new contracts and everything. So all you can do now on the blockchain, it's in this unified execution model, it's all possible. Okay, one last remark before I'm done. Type checking is now part of the attack surface, right? So this is why it's important that it's in linear time. So now the contract, okay, you probably only want to type check it once, and then you can trust that it like implements really like the set session type. But the client code, you potentially have to check for each transaction. So this would be another source of denial of service attacks. So that's why type checking has to be efficient. So this is why we don't have refinement types or dependent types in the language, because then you don't have efficient type checking anymore. You can still do full functional verification like you do it with other languages too. We have an operational semantics. You can prove in Coq, let's say, you know, whatever you want about these programs. This is not a limitation. This is a design choice that we made. Okay, with that, I end. Sorry for running over.
Okay, thank you for the talk. Any questions? Additional questions? Yeah.
So a question about this automatic advertised resource analysis. So you've shown this table of different algorithms and runtime bounds. So these were worst case runtime bounds.
Yep.
So I'm not sure whether I understood what exactly this advertised then means. So would it be possible with your method to study a data structure like union find, for example, and get this iterated logarithm results?
Well, yeah, I mean, union find, of course, not because the, as you say, the has like iterated logarithm or even reverse Ackermann, I think some implementations. Yeah, right. So the, we cannot just not express it, but you know, being like less ambitious. So the stat, we can do amortized analysis, hence the name. For instance, if you implement a functional queue with two stacks, and then you know you enqueue in the first stack, you dequeue from the second stack, and when the second one is empty, you copy over. So this is something we can analyze. So for instance, you use this to implement press-first search, for instance, so we can show that press-first search has a linear cost using these queues.
You have to specify then how often which function is called or which order?
No, everything completely automatic.
Yeah. Other question there? Yeah.
I was just wondering, to what extent could you transfer all of this to another language? So I mean, the language looks nice, but is, for example, being a functional language somehow inherent in the approach?
No, we did that. It's just nice in a functional language because you get a lot of information about the shape of the bounds from the types. But you can do it for imperative languages. It's actually quite related to separation logic. You can define kind of like this potential as being part of your inductive predicate. Bob Edke did that a while ago, got it, I think 10 years ago. And now even in the Libra team, Shaz Kadir is thinking about, Ankush did an internship there, integrating that into the MOVE language also to have data structures that carry this potential because they are based on Rust. And they have also already linear type systems, so it's a very nice fit for them too.
Okay.
So Jan, I guess a little worry about the worst case analysis, right? Because you're doing this guess usage. Yeah, if your estimation is just way high than what's used.
Right.
Yeah, and people may get wrong information.
Yeah, so that's a concern. So what if the gas usage is an over approximation? So a couple of answers. So the first answer is it's really not that bad because the gas cost is already kind of random to start with. What you take for your, basic operations. The only thing you want is you don't want to underestimate. So overestimation is still kind of like safe. And what the exact cost is, I mean, in the end, the gas cost is not the main cost of the transactions anyway. So it's not such a big concern. You can, however, change the type system so that the bounds have to be kind of like precise. You can never waste potential. You can do that. It makes the kind of like system a bit more limited in what you can implement. That's the second thing. The third thing is you can still do dynamic tracking on top of it and just say you take it as a kind of like a guarantee that you don't run out. You track it dynamically and you refund it. It's also possible.
There was another project from CME called Obsidian. There was another project from CME called Obsidian where they also introduced linear types for capturing resources and also a time system for capturing time state. So would the main advantage of NOMOS being the resource
Yeah, so in Obsidian, it's more like a project that is trying to improve on Solidity and adding these features to Solidity. I mean, some of the ideas are similar, like linear types, but this is like in general in the space, a lot of people who design programming languages for the smart contracts add linear types anyway. And the Obsidian is very different from Nomos. I mean, they use, it's more like Solidity plus these additional features.
Okay, so yes, let's take the rest of the questions offline. Let's thank Jan again for the talk.